എല്ലാവർക്കും താങ്ക് യു സോ മച്ച് ഈ സെഷന് ജോയിൻ ചെയ്തതിന്. അപ്പോൾ എല്ലാവർക്കും എന്താ പറയുക, ഈ നമ്മളുടെ ഒരു ഒരു ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ടിൽ പറയണമെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ, നമ്മൾ മണി ടോക്സ് വിത്ത് നിഖിൽ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ പ്രോഗ്രാം ഒരു രണ്ട് വർഷത്തെ കൂടുതലായി നമ്മൾ ഹാൻഡിൽ ചെയ്യാൻ തുടങ്ങിയിട്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ഇതിൽ ഒത്തിരി ആളുകൾക്ക് മണി റിലേറ്റഡ് ഇൻഫോർമേഷൻസ് പറയാം എന്നുള്ളതാണ് നമ്മൾ ഇതിൻ്റെ ഒരു മോട്ടീവ് ഇത് ചെയ്തതിൻ്റെ പേരിൽ. അപ്പോൾ ബേസിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള സേവിങ്സ്, ബേസിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബഡ്ജറ്റിങ്, ബേസിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള എന്തൊക്കെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻ്റ് ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റികളാണ് ഉള്ളതിനെ കുറിച്ച് എന്നൊക്കെ നമ്മൾ സംസാരിക്കാറുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ പല പല സെഷനിലായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ പല പല കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഹാൻഡിൽ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ എസ്പെഷ്യലി നമുക്ക് ഈ കോവിഡ് തുടങ്ങണേക്കാളും മുന്നേ തന്നെ നമ്മുടെ ഓഫീസിൽ വിളിച്ചിട്ട് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റർ അവയർനെസ് പ്രോഗ്രാം നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യാറുണ്ട്. അതിൽ ബേസിക് ആയിട്ട് എങ്ങനെ ഫിനാൻഷ്യൽ ഫ്രീഡം അച്ചീവ് ചെയ്യാം, എങ്ങനെ സേവിങ്സ് ജേണി ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങളാണ് നമ്മൾ സംസാരിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ ഇപ്പോൾ കോവിഡ് ആയ സമയത്ത് നമ്മൾ അതിൽ നിന്ന് മാറിയിട്ട് ഓൺലൈനായിട്ട് എല്ലാ ശനിയാഴ്ചകളിലും നമ്മൾ ഇത്തരം വർക്ക്ഷോപ്പുകൾ ഹാൻഡിൽ ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ള ഒരു തീരുമാനത്തിലെടുക്കുകയും അങ്ങനെ നമ്മൾ പല പല സെഷൻസ് നമ്മൾ കൈകാര്യം ചെയ്തു. ഇപ്പോൾ എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു നമ്മളൊരു ഒരു 60-70 സെഷനിൽ കൂടുതൽ നമ്മൾ പല പല ഡിഫറെൻ്റ് ടോപ്പിക്സിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് നമ്മൾ സംസാരിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ ഇപ്പോൾ ഒരു ഒരു 5 സെഷനായിട്ട് നമ്മളൊരു ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് എക്സ്പേർട്ട് സീരീസ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ടാണ് നമ്മളിപ്പോൾ ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഇതിൽ നമ്മുടെ ഉദ്ദേശം എന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ ഓൾ ഇന്ത്യ ലെവലിൽ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് എക്സ്പേർട്ടായിട്ടുള്ള ആളുകളെ നമ്മുടെ സെഷനിലേക്ക് ക്ഷണിക്കാനും ഓരോരോ വ്യത്യസ്ത ടോപ്പിക്കുകളെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് സംസാരിക്കണം എന്നുള്ള ഒരു ഉദ്ദേശത്തോടെയാണ് നമ്മൾ ചെയ്തത്. അപ്പോൾ ഞാൻ മാത്രമല്ല, നമ്മുടെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് വേൾഡിലുള്ള ഒത്തിരി ആൾക്കാർക്ക് ഒത്തിരി ഡിഫറെൻറ്റ് എക്സ്പീരിയൻസുകൾ ഉണ്ടാവും, ഡിഫറെൻറ്റ് എക്സ്പേർട്ടൈസ് ഉണ്ടാവും. അപ്പോൾ ഇതിനെ മാക്സിമം യൂസ് ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ള ഉദ്ദേശത്തോടെയാണ് നമ്മൾ ഈ ഒരു സെഷൻ ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ നമുക്ക് ഇതിനു മുന്നും നമ്മൾ ഡെറ്റ് മ്യൂച്വൽ ഫണ്ടിലും FDയിലും ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നതിൻ്റെ സേഫ്റ്റിനെ കുറിച്ച് നമ്മൾ സംസാരിച്ചു. അപ്പോൾ അന്നത്തെ സെഷനിൽ വന്ന ഒരു കാര്യമാണ്, ഇപ്പോൾ ബോണ്ടും ഡിബഞ്ചേഴ്സും അവൈലബിൾ ആണ്, അതിൽ എങ്ങനെ ഡയറക്റ്റ് ആയിട്ട് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ളതിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ജോയ്ദീപ് സെൻ സാറിൻ്റെ എക്സ്പേർട്ടൈസ് പറയണമെന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ, ഇതിൽ എങ്ങനെ ഡെറ്റിലും ഇപ്പോൾ ഫിക്സ്ഡ് ഇൻകം ഇൻസ്ട്രുമെൻസിൽ എങ്ങനെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യണം എന്നുള്ളതിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് ഹാൻഡിൽ ചെയ്യാനായിട്ട് വളരെ നല്ലൊരു എക്സ്പേർട്ടായിട്ടുള്ള ആളാണ് ജോയ്ദീപ് സെൻ സാർ. അപ്പോൾ ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ കരിയറിൽ നല്ലൊരു ഭാഗം BNP പരിവാസിന് വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ഫിക്സ്ഡ് ഇൻകം ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെൻറ്റ് ഹെഡ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ എല്ലാവർക്കും മനസ്സിലാവും ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ ഒരു റിയൽ എക്സ്പേർട്ടൈസ് എന്താണെന്നുള്ളത്. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഒത്തിരി ഇപ്പം തന്നെ ഇന്ത്യയിലത്തെ മെയിൻ ആയിട്ടുള്ള പബ്ലിഷിംഗ് ഹൗസസിൽ എല്ലാത്തിലും ഒത്തിരി ആർട്ടിക്കിളുകൾ ഇദ്ദേഹം കോൺട്രിബ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. ഇപ്പോൾ വീക്കിലി നമുക്ക് ലിങ്ക്ഡിൻ പ്രൊഫൈലിൽ ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിനെ നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ കാണാൻ പറ്റും. മിൻഡിനും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ET9 എല്ലാത്തിനും വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് നമുക്ക് ഒത്തിരി ആർട്ടിക്കിളുകൾ നമ്മൾ ഇദ്ദേഹം ഷെയർ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. 4 പുസ്തകങ്ങൾ ഇദ്ദേഹം പേഴ്സണൽ ഫിനാൻസിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടും ഫിക്സ്ഡ് ഇൻകത്തിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടൊക്കെ എഴുതിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അക്കാഡമിക്കലായിട്ടായാലും നമ്മുടെ പേഴ്സണൽ ഫിനാൻസ് ജേണി ഇമ്പ്രൂവ് ആക്കാനായിട്ടുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങളെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് ഇദ്ദേഹം എഴുതിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു മെൻറ്ററിങ് ഇതിനെക്കുറിച്ച്, ബോണ്ട് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടും ഡിബഞ്ചേഴ്സ് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെൻറ്റിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടും ഉള്ള ഒരു എക്സ്പേർട്ടൈസ് കിട്ടാന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഇറ്റ്സ് എ വാല്യൂ ആഡഡ് അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ് ഫോർ അസ്. അപ്പോൾ ഇന്നത്തെ സെഷന് വിതൗട്ട് എനി ഫർദർ അഡ്യൂ, ലെറ്റ് മീ ഇൻവൈറ്റ് ജോയ്ദീപ് സെൻ സാർ ടു കണ്ടക്ട് ദ സെഷൻ, ഹൗ ടു ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ഇൻ കോർപ്പറേറ്റ് ബോണ്ട് ആൻഡ് ബോണ്ട്സ് ഫോർ എ റീറ്റെയിൽ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റേഴ്സ്. സർ, യുനോ വിത്ത് ലവ് ആൻഡ് റെസ്പെക്ട്, ലെറ്റ് മീ വെൽക്കം ടു അവർ ഓഡിയൻസ്.
Thank you, Nikhil. Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. And it's good to meet once again. So we met last, or maybe the first time, on 3rd of July. And this is the second time we are meeting. And I picked up 3 words from Google. That is, Enne Shani Chanu Nandi. Is that correct?
Enne Shani Chanu Nandi. Correct.
Yeah. Okay. So I got it right.
Yeah.
So the topic, as you said, about investing in bonds directly. So just to take it up from the previous session, we discussed the safety aspect, as in the credit rating and all those aspects about deposits and about debt mutual funds. Today we will discuss, like you said, investing directly in bonds. So what is this thing? Let us say in an equity mutual fund, in an equity mutual fund, we are buying units of the mutual fund. And the mutual fund is buying equity stocks of various companies in the portfolio. Similarly, in a debt mutual fund, we buy units of the mutual fund, and the debt fund, they buy instruments like bonds and other instruments from the market. So this also is possible in the sense that you can buy bonds directly, but there is a slight difference there. The slight difference is equity market is very widespread. It is very liquid. You can buy big ticket, you can buy small sizes, anything you can do. The various brokerages, there are so many brokerages all over India. Now we have online apps, and it is very easy and very convenient. However, in the debt market, it is not so this thing, in the sense that it is not so widespread and liquidity is not as good. But yes, in spite of these challenges, the market is developing, market is growing, and it is possible within the constraints to invest in bonds directly. So I will start my presentation. I have a small PPT so that we have more time for the questions and answers. I will start sharing the PPT now. And after that, we will have questions. Yeah, is the screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah, I will just maximize it. And then I have to get my chat box back, because when I do a screen sharing, my chat box goes away. Just hold on. I think I'm getting it now. Yeah. So I have got my chat box, right. Okay. So this is the agenda for the day. We will discuss corporate deposits. We will discuss corporate bonds, some of the types of corporate bonds available in the market, and how to invest in corporate bonds. So last time we discussed briefly about bank deposits. In a way, bank deposits and corporate deposits are similar in the sense you are keeping a deposit with an entity like a bank or a company. There's a fine difference. The fine difference is the safety or the implied safety aspect. Now, when you are keeping your money in a bank, now within quote, a bank is a bank, whereas a company is not a bank. So what it means is when you go for corporate deposits, you have to go with those corporates which are safe or perceived to be safe, who have a goodwill, and so that your money also is safe. So what it means is don't go only by the rate offered by the bank or the company or the other entity with whom you are putting your money, because it is your hard-earned money. You have to look at the safety aspect as well. So as you can see on screen, you can read the screen, corporate deposits or company fixed deposits are term deposits where you keep your money with the company for a fixed tenure of time. Now, as compared to a bank, so if you do a like-to-like comparison, a very high quality, good quality bank and a high quality, goodwill, AAA rating kind of company, the corporate deposit rate is slightly higher because, and as I said, the implied safety aspect. So as an example, if SBI gives say 5% or whatever percent, let's say it is 5%, some other good company will give you more than 5%, even though it is AAA rated and even though they have a goodwill and all those things. There's a slight difference in that. So as long as the company is safe, you can earn a slightly higher return by putting your money, by keeping your money in corporate deposits. Now, there are so many companies available and so many companies are accepting fixed deposits. So how would you choose? So it is the credit rating. So there is a credit rating. So when you do a Google search, go to the website of the company, they will say our rating is so and so, like AAA, AA, single A, those ratings you will find on the website or through Google. Mind you, ratings are of separate instruments. So there would be a rating of the bond issued by the company. There would be a rating of the deposits of the company. There would be a rating of other instruments issued by the company. And sometimes, rarely, there may be a rating of the company as a whole overall, but that is rare. usually companies take ratings for their instruments. Instruments means it could be bonds, debentures, deposits, or any other instrument the company may issue. So I'm showing you two examples. This is HDFC Limited, rated AAA. So as I said, go with companies with a name, within quote name, name as in like HDFC or Tata or any company where you have faith, who have a goodwill to protect. So here I'm showing an example of HDFC Limited, rated AAA, and you can see on screen, or it's a very simple thing. You can just do a Google, go to the website, and you can find out these rates. So as an example, HDFC Limited, they are saying for a 33-month period, monthly income plan, the rate is 6%, quarterly option is 6.05, half yearly 6.1, and so on and so forth. Then other tenures, like 15 months, 22 months, they have these rates, whatever, 5%, 5%, they have these rates. I will show you one more example of corporate deposit. This is Mahindra Finance, rated AAA. So again, you can see on screen the rates mentioned by them, 5.7, 6.2, 6.45. Additional rates for senior citizens. So you can simply go to the website, do a Google. But as I said, stick to the better ones like HDFC or Tata or Mahindra or Bajaj Finance, the AAA variety. Okay. So response you can type in the chat box. Between these two corporate deposits, which one would you prefer? A deposit with a credit rating of AAA and a deposit with a credit rating of AA. Okay, AAA. Some more responses, please. Yes. So everybody's saying AAA, right? You got it right. So I'm not saying that AA will default, but the point is a company is a company, not a bank. Hence, rather than for those little bit of extra interest rate, you would rather keep your money safe and go for a AAA rated corporate deposit, right? So let's move on. Now we move on to corporate bonds, which is a little more complicated part. So as I said, when you buy a mutual fund, a debt mutual fund unit, you are buying a unit in a portfolio where in the portfolio, the mutual fund is buying various bonds or other instruments issued by various companies. And now we come to I'll show some types of corporate bonds. So what is the definition of a bond? It is a debt, security, or loan agreement, obligation, or promise. To put it very simply, a deposit is one-to-one. In the sense, when you deposit with a bank or a company, it is not transferable. It may be possible to withdraw your deposit prior to maturity, but it is not possible to sell your deposit prior to maturity. As in, you cannot sell your deposit to somebody else. It is one-on-one between the bank or the company and you. A bond also is a loan in the sense you have given a loan to the company. Like you give, in a way, your deposit is a loan. In a way, it is a loan given by you to the bank or the company. A bond also is, in a way, a loan you have given to that bank or the company, but it is transferable in the sense you can sell the loan you have given to the company to another person, and that is called the secondary market. So one is the primary market, when for the first time the company is issuing that security, that debt security called bond or debenture, it is primary. Afterwards, that security changes hands in the secondary market. And that is the difference between a bond and a deposit. A deposit is not transferable, a bond is transferable. So here I'm showing you some of the features or aspects of bonds. If you don't catch everything, don't worry. There are lots of features to tell you briefly. Issuer types. So there are various types of issuers. The best quality is the government, which is called sovereign, like the government of India or the various state governments. The coupon rate is the interest rate. There's a defined maturity date, like 5 years, 7 years, 3 years. Yield to maturity, what we call YTM, yield to maturity, or simply yield. So that is the effective annualized return you will get when you invest in that bond or debenture. Market price is the price in the secondary market. So how is that different from the issue price? Let us say, as an example, there's a bond with a face value of rupees 100. When the company issued it for the first time in the primary market, the price was rupees 100 and you purchased for rupees 100. Afterwards, when that bond is changing hands in the secondary market, the price would be either 100 or more than 100 or less than 100. And why does it change? That change is to adjust for interest rate movements in the market. So in the market, interest rates prevailing in the economy, rate goes up, rate comes down. Now the face value remains same, and the coupon rate, which is the rate of interest, that is always fixed as a percentage of the face value. So if the coupon rate is say 7% of face value, it is always rupees 7 per rupees 100. That does not change. However, in the market, when interest rates change, the price has to adjust. The price from 100, maybe 100, 200, 310 or 95, 93, that adjusts to adjust for interest rate changes in the economy. So there are multiple types of bonds. I will show you in detail two types of bonds. So one is the simple, usual, conventional bond, where you buy, you get a coupon rate as defined, like 7%, 8%, 6%, that defined coupon rate you get. And that coupon is taxable at your rate. So if you're in, say, 30% tax bracket, you pay tax at 30% plus surcharge and cess. So I will show you in particular two types among the multiple types of bonds available in the market. So one is this tax-free PSU bond. What is this tax-free PSU bond? In these bonds, the coupon you get or the interest you get, that is free of tax. Now, some people call this tax-free government bond. Mind you, there is no tax-free government bond. What we have is certain AAA rated PSUs with a special permission from the government. They have issued these bonds and the coupon is tax-free. So some of the aspects of these tax-free PSU bonds, these have been issued by certain PSUs. Not each and every PSU can issue this. Only certain defined PSUs can issue this thing. And they obtained or they had special government permission to issue bonds of this category. All these are AAA rated, so it is very safe, AAA rated PSU. And the return I will show you on these bonds is, you know, what I have put within quote, the pre-tax equivalent. The pre-tax equivalent concept is, if you invest in some other bond, usual, regular, normal bond, the coupon is, say, whatever, 7% coupon. That 7% is taxable at 30% plus surcharge and cess. Whereas here, the coupon is tax-free. So if we have to do a like-to-like comparison, so I am getting this bond at, say, 4.4%, and some other bond is at, say, 7%. That 7% is taxable. So for a like-to-like comparison, I have to gross up this 4.4% for a level comparison. That is the concept of grossing up at my tax rate. So my 4.4% return grossed up at my tax rate gives you the comparable level with some other bond in the market, which is taxable. So it is like this, if your tax rate is 30% and the rate is 4.4%, the pre-tax equivalent, which we are discussing, how it is derived, you divide 4.4 by 1 minus 30%. So you divide 4.4 by 0.7, which is 1 minus, or maybe 100 minus 30%, and you get 6.29%. Now, nowadays, you do not get this level, this level of yield or YTM or yield to maturity in the market from a good quality AAA rated PSU. So from that point of view, even today, tax-free bonds are a good buy because it is safe and the rate apparently low, but you have to look at the pre-tax equivalent for comparison. How does taxation of bonds work? Listed bonds, listed means listed at the exchange. Over a holding period of 1 year, as in from your purchase date to your redemption or maturity, redemption date, sale date, it has to be a holding period of 1 year. Then it becomes long-term capital gain. So this LTCG, long-term capital gain, is taxable at 10%. However, the coupon is always taxable at your marginal rate. So if your marginal rate is 30%, the coupon is always taxable at 30%. Only the capital gains component. So as an example, if you buy a bond of say 7% coupon at a price of say 110 rupees, after 1.5 years, you sell that at 111 rupees. That 1 rupee is your capital gain. Listed bond holding period more than 1 year, that 1 rupee gain is taxable at 10% plus surcharge and cess. In between, whatever 7% coupon you receive, that is taxable at your marginal 30% tax rate. So this is the concept I was talking about. You can read the table, the concept of pre-tax equivalent. So tax rates vary in the sense, even at 30%, at various tax brackets, this rate of surcharge will vary. So the net of everything, tax rate as such, plus surcharge and cess, taking into account everything, your final tax rate varies. So if your income bracket is less than 50 lakhs per financial year, the effective rate is 31.2%. If you're in the bracket of say 50 lakh to 1 crore, your effective rate is 34.32%. And at the highest tax lap, where your income is more than rupees 5 crore per financial year, the effective tax rate is as high as 42.74%. So as an example, taking 4.4% as the return, as the yield from a tax-free PSU bond, at an income level of 30% plus surcharge and cess of less than 50 lakh, 4.4% at 31.2% tax rate, the effective pre-tax equivalent is 6.4%. So that goes up 6.4, 6.7, 6.86. And at the highest bracket, it is 7.68%. So that is the real return or effective comparison purpose return from a tax-free PSU bond. So these are the instruments or issuers. So all this NHAI is National Highway Authority of India. IRFC is Indian Railway Finance Corporation and all those. PFC is Power Finance Corporation, RAC is Rural Electrification Corporation. So all these companies are rated AAA, rather the bonds are rated AAA by CRISIL-ICRA and other rating agencies. And these are safe. So who should invest? People in a higher tax bracket, HNIs and all, because the effective return is that much higher. And these are AAA rated PSUs. And mind you, nowadays, there is no fresh issuance of AAA this tax-free bonds. The reason is, over the last 4 or 5 years, the government is not giving any permission for fresh issuance. There has been a big rally. So like 5 years ago, or even earlier, the coupon rate, which is the interest rate on these bonds, was like 8%, 8.2%. Today in the market, the yield is like, say, 4%, 4.25%, 4.5%. Because there has been a rally, and due to the rally, the effective yield returns have come down. It is only the existing stock. There is no fresh stock being issued. So that is a reason for the rally. So last 5 years, there has been no fresh issuance. Just to show you one brief this thing, if it is a conventional bond rated AAA, conventional means simple, usual, regular bond rated AAA, which is a good quality. As an example, if you're getting, say, 5.25% return on that bond, maturity of, say, whatever, 3 years or something, you pay tax at a certain rate, 35.88%, and your net of tax returns, I can't see the screen, is 3.37%. Tax-free PSU 4.4 remains 4.4, as in I have not grossed up here because I've deducted the tax from the previous one. 4.4 remains 4.4 because the coupon is tax-free. I will show you the next category now, something called Bank Additional Tier 1, AT1 Perpetual Bonds. If you get, say, 7.25 as an example, net of tax, it is like 4.65%. Again, there's something called MLD, Market Linked Debentures, where it is a debenture only, but the coupon, it is not fixed. The coupon or the return which you get on this bond is contingent upon some other variable, something else happening in the market. And bank FDD, you know, is the simplest of things to understand. Now, if you look at the right-hand column, net of tax returns, conventional bond, good quality AAA, where you are otherwise getting, say, 5.25%. Effectively, net of tax, you're getting 3.37. Tax-free PSU 4.4 remains 4.4. Bank AT1 perpetual bond, depending on which bank it is possible to get higher yields also. 7, 8, 9 is possible. So that rate is like 4.65 or higher. MLDs also give attractive returns. So the last column towards my right, that gives you the effective picture as to what is the return you get. Okay, so you can type in the chat box. Which of the following would you prefer from the safety point of view? Corporate bonds, mutual funds, bank deposits, corporate deposits. So this is a repeat. This question is a repeat from the previous session, and I've purposefully kept this thing because this is important to understand. The concept is important. Type in the chat box, please. Yes. Any response? Okay. Babu says bank deposits. Maybe Tanya says bank deposits. Okay. Bank deposits, and okay, and MF. Anybody else? Okay, so just to reiterate the answer which I said last time, everything is safe, everything is risky. It's a function of what you are buying or where you are keeping your money or to whom you are giving your money. So within banks also, we have SBI, we have HDFC, we have some, I will not name anybody, lesser banks. There are some cooperative banks. Within cooperative banks also, there are the better ones, there are the not so good ones. In companies, we have the good companies like HDFC, Tata and all, triple rated. We have the not so good companies. In mutual funds, we have government security oriented portfolios. We have triple oriented portfolios. We have credit risk funds. So everything is safe. Everything is risky. You have to understand to whom you're giving your money, where you're keeping your money. What is the credit rating of that or the credit quality of that? So that is more important than going via blanket this thing like, you know, a bank or corporate or whatever. So that is the important thing. Okay, now we come to the next this thing called additional tier one PERP. So what is this thing, AT1 or additional tier one? So as per regulation, bank has a capital which is mostly equity, and part of the capital, so 1.5%, the bank has to issue this product called additional tier one perpetual bonds. So most of the banks have a bond in this category, additional tier one perpetual bonds. So I will show you some of the aspects of this bank additional tier one bonds. So only banks can issue additional tier one perpetual bonds. There are non-banks who have perpetual bonds in the market, like Cholamandalam. They have perpetual bonds in the market, but those are not AT1. Those are not that bank additional tier one perpetual bond. Those are simply perpetual bonds. This category, AT1 perpetual, is issued by banks only. So even though these are perpetual in nature, there is a call option, 5 years. And it is expected that after 5 years, it will be actually called by the bank. Not a compulsion, not a legal compulsion, but yes, that is the expectation in the market that it will be actually called back by the bank. Going by the credit rating, for the same bank, usual regular bonds of the bank and additional tier one perpetual bonds, the rating is different. The AT1 PERP is rated one or two notches below the usual bonds of the same bank. The reason is there are some risk aspects of AT1 bonds. One is something called coupon discretion, which means the bank will pay coupon only if the bank is earning profits. And there is something called loss absorption, which we have seen in the case of Yes Bank. In case of Yes Bank, the entire outstanding AT1 bond, which was 8,415 crores, the entire AT1 issuance was written off by RBI. And the money seems to be lost. The case is in the court of law, High Court, but still, money seems to be lost. So that risk is there. That loss absorption feature is there for additional tier one bonds, which is why rating agencies rate these bonds one or two notches lower than the other bonds of the same bank. Now, even though we have had a bad example like the Yes Bank example, we have some good examples earlier. So earlier, like 3-4 years ago, certain banks, you know, face something called what is called prompt corrective action. Means basically the RBI said you cannot do much of fresh business. Some restrictions were placed on them. And there was a doubt whether these banks would be able to service their AT1 perpetual bonds. And all these banks were PSU banks. So what they did, the RBI, the government, all these banks, they called back their AT1 perps even before call date. So it is like, you know, put an end to the entire story that in case you are doubting whether we can service or not service these 81 perps, we are calling it back and giving our money back even before maturity. So, and mind you, in case of Lakshmi Vilas Bank, so within there's something called Basel III norms followed by banks globally and by RBI also. Under Basel III, there is additional tier one and there is other Basel III bonds. In case of Lakshmi Vilas Bank, it was not 81. It was the other, this thing, other variety, tier two bonds. So Lakshmi Vilas, you don't have 81, but the other variety, that also was written off by the RBI. So two bad examples, Yes Bank and Lakshmi Vilas Bank. So as I said, call option after 5 years, and it is expected that they will actually call back after 5 years. So this SEBI circular, not to go too deep into it. Basically, SEBI issued this circular in October last year. And what they said is that for fresh issuances of 81 perpetual bonds, the minimum ticket size will be rupees 1 crore and only something called QIB, as in qualified institutional buyers. Only these QIBs can buy these bonds. So net-net, where we stand today is individuals. It is possible for individuals to buy, and it is possible for individuals to buy in lot size of less than 1 crore in the existing issuances, as in, as on 12th October 2020, whatever existing issuance was there of additional tier 1 perpetual bank bonds, those bonds individuals can purchase, can trade in lots of less than 1 crore, like whatever, 10 lakhs or whatever lot size is there. So what is the rationale for investment? The rationale for investment is, in spite of certain cases like Yes Bank case, there are banks like SBI, there are banks like HDFC, or there are other good quality banks who have additional tier one bonds. And we cannot say SBI will default or HDFC will default just because Yes Bank case has happened. So somewhere we have to keep the faith and somewhere we have to draw the line. And between the usual regular bonds of the same bank and the 81 bonds of that bank, you get an additional return. So in the range of say 70 basis to 1%, so 70 to 100 basis points, so 0.7 to 1% approximately. That is the higher return you get in additional tier one perpetual bonds. And that is the rationale to buy. As long as you have faith in the bank, like any PSU bank, which will not default. So somewhere you have to keep the faith and you can buy these bonds. This is an example of the credit rating. So as you see, not a single 81 bond, 81 perp is rated AAA. Not even SBI, not even HDFC, because of these risk factors. The highest rating is AA+. As you can see, we have Axis Bank AA+. We have BOB, Bank of Baroda AA+. We have HDFC AA+, ICICI AA+, and Indian Bank AA+, and of course, SBI AA+. So these are the bonds AA+, which is the highest rating for 81 perpetuals. So as an example, I'm showing you about 1 lakh crore, now it is little lower, 90,000 crore of 81 bonds outstanding in the market. Okay, so you can type in the chat box, which of the two instruments is safer issued by the same bank? Fixed deposits, 81 bonds. Yes, please type in the chat box. Yes, Fibonacci FD. That acronym rhymes. FD, Fibonacci. So FD says FD. Primjins Karia says FD. Okay. Anybody else? Any other view? Babu says fixed deposit. Yes. So you're right, it is fixed deposit only. So if it is the same bank, FD is safer because FD, fixed deposit, does not have those two aspects. That one is called coupon discretion, that the bank will pay coupon only if the bank is in profits, and that thing called loss absorption, which we saw in the case of Yes Bank. But mind you, if the banks are different, then you have to see, because if you have a very safe SBI kind of bank, and you have some obscure cooperative bank, which is not so good. So that you have to take care of. Okay, so I'll now show you the summary slide of corporate bonds and the net of tax comparison. That will give you a perspective. So lots of numbers on this slide, so don't worry, take your time and go through it gradually. What I'm showing here is, one is you have your tax rate. So assuming you're in 30% bracket, 30% is your tax rate. Then you have surcharge and then you have cess. So depending on your income slab, like less than 50 lakh to more than 5 crore, your effective tax rate varies. So 31.2%, 34.3%. The highest, as in if your income is more than 5 crore per year, it is 42.74%. And the LTCG rate is for a listed bond, the capital gain component that is taxable at LTCG for a holding period of more than 1 year. So at 10%, the rate is 10.4 at the lower end, as in less than 50 lakh. At the higher end, it is 14.25%. So tax-free PSU, we already discussed, just to reiterate as an example. If we have, let's say, 4.35% for a 7-10 year maturity tax-free PSU bond. At the lower end, we have the effective pre-tax at 6.32. At the higher end, we have 7.6%. And for a shorter maturity tax-free bond, the yield is even lower, say 3.7%. So 3.7% corresponds to like 5.38 to 5.46%. Only if you're buying a, say, 10-year kind of maturity tax-free PSU, you get like 4.35, 4.4% approximately kind of return, where your effective pre-tax is 6.32 to 7.6%. Okay, now this thing called market-linked debenture, to tell you briefly what this thing is, a market-linked debenture is like any other bond debenture only. The difference being there is no coupon in it and there is no defined return in it. That return is contingent upon something else happening in the market, like some equity or some G-Sec yield or some gold or anything, any other variable. Now, apparently, even though your return is not fixed, there are certain fixed income oriented MLDs where the condition is kept in such a way that in a way you have an indication that how much you will earn. So like if it is 7% or 5%, 6%, you have the idea how much you are going to earn from this. The advantage or USP of this thing called MLD is that it is taxable at 10%. So how does that happen? There is no coupon. So from start to finish, you don't get any coupon, but you get a return. And that return is determined, is contingent upon some, say, equity or some bond or some gold or something. The entire return over the life of the instrument, like 1.5 years, 2 years, or whatever is the life of the instrument, the entire thing is put to tax at 10% plus surcharge and cess. So as I said, in a usual bond, taxable bond, even though the LTCG component is taxable at 10% rate, the coupon is always taxable at your marginal rate, which is 30% plus surcharge and cess. Here, the entire component is taxable at 10%. That means, in simple language, what is happening is 30% tax rate is coming down to 10% tax rate. That is the advantage, that is the USP of this instrument, this idea called MLD, market-linked debenture. So here is an example, 8.4, okay, 8.4 is too rosy. It's difficult to get that much of a return. But as an example, if 8.4 is there in a MLD, that corresponds to the lower end to 7.53. And on the higher end of tax bracket, it is like 7.2% because they're paying a higher tax rate. Okay, cumulative redeemable rated preference shares. So even though preference share is a share, in a way, it behaves like a bond because there's a defined maturity date and there's a defined, I won't say coupon, but dividend, but even though it is technically dividend being a share, it is somewhat like a coupon only because there's a defined rate. So if it is a 6% defined rate, that 6% dividend is in a way like a coupon. And there's a credit rating also. So earlier, preference shares had a preferred taxation rate, but that is gone now for the last 2 years. Tax rate is same like anything else. So if you get, say, 7.4%, effectively you get all these rates, like 5.09 to 4.24, depending on your tax bracket. Bank 81 POP, we discussed. So as an example, if it is 7.4%, your effective return varies from 5.09 to 4.24%. Look at the last one, high yielding, 11%. Now, whether you will take that risk is up to you. So if you are of the belief that a bank is a bank, or in particular, if it is a PSU bank, even if it is low rated, a government bank will not default, then it is possible you get as much as 11% return. 11% corresponds to like 7.57 to 6.3, which is attractive, or mid-range, like 9%, which is not too risky. Reasonable quality banks are available, double-rated banks are available in that range. 9% corresponds to 6.19 to 5.15%. And then this is the conventional usual bond, corporate bond, private sector, taxable. So 3-year triple as an example, if it is say 5.5, you get 3.78 to 3.15 net of tax. If it is 6.85, you get like 4.71 to 3.92%. So this is the nutshell. Net of tax, these are the bonds you can buy directly. So there are those usual regular bonds, private sector, PSU, and there are some special categories like tax-free PSU, bank, AT1 POP, additional tier one perpetual, and then there are MLDs, which are certain special categories which you can buy from the market. And one or two things I have not mentioned in the PPT, but I'll tell you verbally. So I saw a question in the chat box earlier about NRIs. So somehow not all bonds are eligible for NRIs. So as per RBI rule broadly, NRIs are eligible to invest in corporate bonds, but somehow the rule is that for the particular issuance, the company has to approach RBI and take the permission that yes, we want to make it eligible for NRIs also. Now, as a practice, only a few companies do that. What is the reason? The reason is issuances are largely domestic, as in issuers know, or the merchant banker tells them that you are targeting this much of amount, this much of amount is possible to get domestically. So why would somebody spend the time and energy to go to the RBI and seek permission and all that? Which is why only a very few corporate bonds here and there are eligible for NRIs, where the company, the issuer, they have approached RBI and obtained that permission. So how to find it out? There is the issue document, which we call IM, as an information memorandum. So in the information memorandum, you get this thing called who can apply thing. So in that who can apply thing, if you find this NRI thing mentioned, NRI eligible, otherwise, even though technically it may be possible to buy, but it is not safe in the sense, you know, since NRIs are not eligible in that issuance. So what can you do? So as an example, what you can do is, if you are an NRI and you intend to purchase a bond, a corporate bond, you have to get in touch with, say, Nikhil, and Nikhil will get in touch with the bond house, who have a quote sheet of bonds. And for the particular bond where you have an interest, Nikhil will ask the bond house that this particular bond, is it available for domestic Indians only, or is it open to NRIs also? So on a case-to-case basis, you have to find out that thing, that NRI thing. And the other aspect is minimum lot size. So as I said, the bond market is not so liquid, not like the equity market. So like the equity market, as you know, you can just download some app, open an account there, and you can simply trade in equities. So the bond market being not so liquid, certain bond houses are there who are reasonably active in the market, but they have a stipulation of a minimum lot size, as in less than rupees so much of deal size, we don't deal. In the sense that they are positioned largely in the either in the wholesale institutional market or in the HNI market, minimum so much of deal size or ticket size, as we call it. There would be certain other bond houses also who would be willing to deal in a small ticket size also. So as an example, one bond house may say minimum 10 lakh. We'll not deal below 10 lakh of deal size. And somebody else may say, even deal size of say 50,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees, we deal. The difference is the one dealing with a smaller ticket size of say 50,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees, they will keep a higher margin because, you know, they have to, you know, justify the time. Somebody is unmute, I think. So to justify the time they're spending on this thing and the deal size being small, whatever, like 50,000 or 1 lakh or 2 lakh rupees, the margin they keep is higher. So you have to be aware of that. And the bond houses were in the HNI segment, deal size of whatever, 10, 20, 30 lakhs. The margin they keep would be lower. So when you are buying a smaller lot, you have to be aware of this thing. So I think that's about it from my side. We can have lots of questions. Understood, reiterate. These books are there. Physical copies, hard copies are there on Amazon and Flipkart. And only the mutual fund book is available in soft copy and Kindle. Otherwise, all the books are there in hard copy. So these are the links. So I think I will stop the monologue here and we'll open for the discussion. So Nikhil, should I minimize, stop share this thing, my presentation?
Yeah, you can stop sharing. We will take questions. Thank you so much, Jyotip sir. I think it's we all have heard that there is something called a bond and companies borrow money from retail, but we always have this confusion that what is it? In theory, we know that equity is ownership, debt is the companies borrowing money from us. But what is that implication, especially when you connected with the tax? I think it was something which is eye-open for many people. And what are the areas which you have to cover? Few questions I have is that we have this question, like in your presentation itself, you have shown that you have a corporate deposits, you have a corporate bond, then we have a bank deposit. Why a one person should look as a corporate bond or a deposit over the bank FDs which is available? So what would be your comment on this thought?
So firstly, on the corporate deposit, as I said earlier, you may get a rate higher. Right. As an example, if SBI is giving a deposit rate of, say, whatever, 5 or 5.5%, or why is that the same house, HDFC Bank. If HDFC Bank deposit rate is, say, whatever, 5 or 5.5%, for HDFC Limited, which is not a bank, HDFC Limited corporate deposit, the rates we saw, whatever, I think, whatever, 6% or whatever we saw. So whatever that number is, as long as it is safe, as long as the company is good, I get a higher return. And the other part of it is the bonds, as in, why not keep money in a bank? Why invest in bonds? Now, one is the return as such, as in the headline number. The headline as in, I place a deposit in a bank at say 5 or 6% deposit rate, and I buy a bond at a yield of whatever, 6%, 5%, 7%, whatever yield. I can compare, easy to compare, like to like. Then comes the tax aspect. Bank deposit always taxable at your marginal rate, 30% plus surcharge and cess. The usual conventional bond, that also is taxable at your marginal rate. The coupon part is taxable at your marginal rate, 30%. Only the capital gain is taxable at the 10% rate. But within that, as I showed you, if you get a good quality AAA PSU tax-free bond at say 4.4% yield, even though apparently it is only 4.4, not like 5 or 6, as I showed you, the pre-tax equivalent. For a good quality, safe AAA PSU, you're getting a pre-tax equivalent of whatever, 6-7%. That is another reason. And the other thing, like I showed you, this bank, 81 perpetual bonds. Okay, there's a case of mis-selling also. So like if you go back to the Yes Bank case, it is all over the media, and it's not just the media, it is a reality also. It was mis-sold in the sense, people at the bank told their customers that if you keep your money in Yes Bank deposits, you get whatever, X percent. If you buy this thing called 81 perpetual bonds of the same bank, you get a much higher rate, like 1% higher, 2% higher, whatever that is. And they did not communicate the risk aspect of it. So even to many senior citizens, they said it's like a deposit only, and senior citizens purchased this thing, not being aware that this is not the same thing as a bank deposit. But having said that, having communicated the risk aspect, if it is like I said, a good quality bank like SBI or HDFC, and where we have to assume that SBI or HDFC cannot default. If that bank is giving a deposit rate of whatever, 5 or 5.5 or 6%, and if for the same bank, the 8-year perpetual bond in the market is available at a yield of say 7 or 8%, as long as you are aware of the risk and confident that this bank will not default, you get a better rate of interest.
Okay. I think the whole idea is that trying to understand what is the risk associated. Yes. Based on that, take a call on that.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, cool. Thank you. ഇപ്പോ ആരെങ്കിലും നമ്മുടെ അടുത്ത് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചോദിക്കാം. ഇപ്പോ ബാബുവിന്റെ ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഉണ്ട്, അത് ചോദിക്കാം. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ആരെങ്കിലും എന്തെങ്കിലും മലയാളത്തിൽ ചോദിക്കണം എന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചോദിച്ചോളൂ, ഞാൻ ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഞാൻ സാറിനോട് ചോദിച്ചോളാം. അതല്ല നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഓപ്പൺ ആയിട്ട് ഇംഗ്ലീഷിൽ ചോദിക്കണമെങ്കിൽ അതും ചോദിച്ചോളൂ. ഓക്കെ, Thank you. About Namaku, so, sir, okay. Another question we have said this
okay.
is.
Yeah. Okay, Nikhil, there is a question and direct message. I'll read out the question.
Yeah, please.
Before I take the question from Babu. The question is, in case of a default of a secured NCD of a company, what is the chance of getting back the capital and interest and how long it takes? So this is a relevant question and it needs to be clarified. What is the concept of within quote secured bond? The concept of secured bond is there is a charge against the assets of the company. The asset could be land, could be building, could be machinery, could be working capital, could be anything. And it sounds good. It is secured bond. And there's a charge against the assets of the company. But in practical terms, it does not mean much. Because if the company defaults, even though legally you have a charge on that asset of the company, you cannot just go and sell the asset. You have to go to the court of law. And once you go to the court of law, you know how long it takes. So like this gentleman has asked, how much time it takes. You know, once a case starts in a court of law, it drags on for years. It will take a long, long time. So within quote, that secured thing does not mean much. So what you have to go by is, firstly, the credit rating. It is AAA or whatever that rating is. And apart from the credit rating, the standing or the goodwill in the market. So as an example, if you believe whichever promoter group you are comfortable with, it could be Tata's, it could be Muthoot, it could be HDFC, whichever promoter group you are comfortable with, that irrespective of their credit rating, this group will not default. You go with that. Because in case something goes wrong, in case a default happens, even if it is a secured bond, with that legal charge, you cannot really do much. Over the last 2, 3, 4 years, there have been some positive development. If you have heard of it, there is something called IBC NCLT. IBC is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court, and NCLT is National Company Law Tribunal. So under this ABC, you can go to the NCLT and you can file a case for liquidation of the company. The company's ownership may change hands and all those things. The silver lining is this IBC NCLT mechanism is more effective than what we had earlier. But having said that, this IBC NCLT, when does it happen? That is the last stage. As in, either the management, the promoter, the ownership of the company is changing hands, it is being given to some other owner at a discounted price, or the company is being liquidated. And whatever money is there, you get back that amount of money. Yes, the speed of NCLT is faster. Like in a normal, usual court of law, the case may go on for like 5 years, 10 years. In NCLT, it goes on for like whatever, 1 year, 1.5, 2 years. Relatively faster, it happens, but that is the last stage. So go more by the credit rating and goodwill of the company within court secure does not mean much. Yeah, that's it. You are reading one question from, I think, Babu.
So here it's about Babu's question. It's about we in Kerala, we have a Koshamattam bond and Manappuram Muthoot. So they offer higher return. And the question is that, is it really fully guaranteed? So what is the kind of risk associated, I think, if you can explain? That will be good.
Okay, so first is, what is the risk aspect? So this is a subjective thing, as in what is risky, what is not risky, is difficult to put in black and white. So I will give you one example. If you go back, let's say 5 years earlier, what was ILFS? ILFS was a AAA rated PSU, right? So what is the perception of a AAA rated PSU? And I will not name some real estate companies. People used to say that this real estate company is in trouble. Maybe they really are in trouble. But the point is, today ILFS has gone bust and those real estate companies are still there. So what may happen, nobody knows. So what is risky, what is safe? I mean, in a way, it is a gray area. In a way, it is a subjective thing. Rather, I will talk more of some other concept because there's a word guarantee. And if you recall, I started my previous session with the concept of guarantee. So let me see, not you, Nikhil, but anybody in the audience, if you were there in the previous session on 3rd of July, and did anybody recall my quiz questions on guarantee and what was the answer I gave on this guarantee thing? So I'll tell you, there were two quiz questions. The first question was, between a guaranteed investment and a non-guaranteed investment, which one would you prefer? Everybody answered guaranteed. And then I had a second question, follow-up question. So does anyone remember that? Does anyone remember the other question as a follow-up question to that? Okay, good enough, fair enough that you are investing in a hard-earned money and you should definitely prefer a guaranteed investment. Yes. Okay, Babu doesn't remember. Nikhil, you remember? No?
Is it that return on...
No. The thing was, it is like this, the first concept is, I cannot guarantee my own issuance. That is a very basic concept I find missing all over India. You have to get this very basic thing first. Because if I am not good, if my credit profile is not good, and if I am allowed to say it is guaranteed, and just by using the word guarantee, if you feel it is good, an example I'm saying that bonds are being issued by Joydeep, whatever may be my profile, good, bad, whatever. If I'm allowed to use the word guarantee, oh, it is guaranteed. If you ask me, I will say, Are, you're giving money to me. It is 100% guaranteed, 200% guaranteed. You say, Are, wah, 200% guaranteed. It is safe. And I default. What do you do? What do you do with the word guarantee? So guarantee means guarantee given by somebody else. It's a very basic thing missing all over India. I cannot guarantee my investment. It's a very simple this thing. If you go to a bank for taking a loan and the bank asks you for a guarantee, can you guarantee yourself? Oh, you want a guarantee? Okay, I'm giving a writing. It is guaranteed. Or does the bank expect you to get some other person from of a reasonable social standing, of a reasonable net worth who is guaranteeing your loan? So I'll repeat that question. That question was, you have two options. You have a bond issued by Reliance Industries, Mukesh Ambani, which is not guaranteed. On the other hand, you have a guaranteed bond, which is issued by Nirav Modi and guaranteed by Mehul Choksi. Which one would you buy? First question was, between a guaranteed and non-guaranteed investment, which one would you prefer? Everybody said guaranteed good, it's your hard-earned money. On one hand, you have a non-guaranteed bond issued by Mukesh Ambani. On the other hand, you have a bond issued by Nirav Modi, guaranteed by Mehul Choksi. Which one would you prefer? Yes, chat box, please. Yes, anybody, any response? There are 16 participants still. Yes, Babu says Mukesh Ambani. So that is the thing. So there is no guarantee. So sometimes some bonds are guaranteed. Technically, it is called credit enhancement. So how the credit enhancement happens is the company goes to a bank and opens an LC, letter of credit. And on the basis of that LC, letter of credit, the rating agency enhances the credit rating because, you know, it says that if the company does not pay, doesn't have the money to pay, the company has deposited so much of money with us at the bank, and by virtue of that LC, that thing is guaranteed. Or there are certain government companies where the bond issuance is guaranteed by the central or state government. That is a guarantee. Otherwise, if you're talking of these companies like, say, Kosamata, Manapura, Muthoot, there is no guarantee. It is about the goodwill of the issuer. So as long as you have faith in these promoters, like if you know through somebody, if you have faith in these issuers like Kosamata, Manapura, Muthoot, yes, you can go ahead. So that is the thing. Look at the credit rating and the standing of that issuer in the market.
So we just to move from this, we have people, so we have 5 more minutes. So if you have any questions, then kandigil questions in the chat le chodikya, allengil unmute edittu chodikya. അതിനു മുന്നേ എനിക്കുള്ള കുറച്ച് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ചോദിക്കാം. അപ്പോൾ സോ വി ഹാവ് ഡിസ്കസ്ഡ് അബൌട്ട് ദിസ് മാർക്കറ്റ് ലിങ്ക്ഡ് ഡിബഞ്ചേഴ്സ്. സോ കുഡ് യു സീ ദാറ്റ് വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദ വൈ എ പേഴ്സൺ ഷുഡ് തിങ്ക് അബൌട്ട് മാർക്കറ്റ് ലിങ്ക് ഡിബഞ്ചേഴ്സ് ആൻഡ് യു സ്പെസിഫിക്കലി മെൻഷൻ ദ ടാക്സ് അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ് ബട്ട് കുഡ് യു ജസ്റ്റ് യുനോ ടേക്ക് ലിറ്റിൽ മോർ ഫർദർ ദാറ്റ് വാട്ട് ഈസ് ദറ്റ് മേജർ അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ് വൈ വി നീഡ് ടു തിങ്ക് അബൌട്ട് മാർക്കറ്റ് ലിങ്ക് ഡിബഞ്ചേഴ്സ്.
The advantage is only that one, that tax efficiency. There's no other advantage. For an example, let's say Muthoot. if most of these issuing a regular conventional bond at whatever, let us say 8% as an example. Muthoot 8% usual regular bond is taxable at 30%, so you get 8 minus 30%. If Muthoot is issuing MLDs, that 8% is taxable at 10%, so you get 8 minus 10. That's all. Rather, I would mention the drawbacks. The advantage is that thing only, tax this thing only. The drawback is liquidity. So these MLDs are listed at the exchange, but even though they are listed, liquidity is even lower than the usual bonds. So for if you are holding the regular conventional bond of Muthoot, if you want to sell, it is still possible to find a buyer. But for MLDs, it is even more difficult to find a buyer. So in a way, you have to be prepared that whatever the tenure is, like 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 1.5 years, for that tenure, you have to give up your liquidity. It's very difficult to sell. That is the drawback. And apart from tax efficiency, there is no other advantage or there's no other benefit of investing in MLDs.
Okay. So the point is that if a person have like a 2 year horizon and they are going for a bond investment, I think MLD will be a good option if that person's is a tax bracket of 30 plus.
Yes.
Higher bracket, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Exactly. Okay. And what is the kind of... For example, we have mutual funds, debt mutual funds we have. We have corporate mutual debt mutual fund. Why a person should move away from or think about a direct bond market than mutual fund?
So one is diversification. And the other is certain pockets, certain things. So it is like a mutual fund is a mass commodity. It is... It is good commodity, but mass commodity for everybody. So some special pockets, like, you know, if you're in a high tax bracket and if you want to buy a tax-free bond, or like we discussed, MLDs. So those pockets that you can do it directly only, that you cannot do through a mutual fund. Or if you have the risk appetite. So you would be aware that as per SEBI regulation, now mutual funds, they are not buying 81 bonds. Because, you know, SEBI says that a debt fund should not invest in a 81 perpetual bond because it is a quasi-equity instrument. All these features of loss absorption and all those things. Now, without debating the good, bad part of the SEBI thing, practically what is happening is mutual funds are moving away from debt funds, at least, moving away from investing in 81 perpetual bonds. But if you have the understanding of the risk, so there are certain mid-range banks where these 81 bonds are available at say 9%. So on one hand, we have like SBI HFC kind of quality at say around 7-ish percent kind of yield. There are ones like say 11% yield, where it's a not so good bank. 9% is the mid range, but the bank is not so risky. And the default risk is actually on the lower side. Let's say it's a PSU bank. Maybe the bank is in losses or whatever, so the yield is high, but it's a PSU bank. You have the implied safety of PSU bank will not default. If you have the risk appetite, that 9% yield you can achieve only through buying the bond directly. You cannot do it through the mutual fund route. So these pockets you can avail of through buying bonds directly only.
Okay. So it's mainly for a higher net worth people.
Yes. And another point is the cost. Cost in the sense a mutual fund, whatever the expense ratio is, so much percentage per year. That is every year. Whereas when you're buying an equity or a bond directly, whatever transaction cost is the initial, that is one time.
Okay.
So if you buy the equity once or the bond once and hold it for whatever, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years, that transaction cost you incur only once.
Okay. So there is no asset management charge we have to incur.
Yes. So not every year recurring kind of thing.
And, you know, we are approaching the time, but just can you just touch upon what is that peer-to-peer investing, because now people are talking a lot and it's everyone have a thinking that it's a fixed return, it's a higher return. So can you just touch upon that?
Yeah, sure. So what is the concept of peer-to-peer? So if you look at our earlier economic structure, like village-based, or even today we have a certain village-based economy. So there where people know each other, they would lend. Now, being a kind of unstructured kind of thing, somebody in trouble, somebody requiring money and that kind of thing, the rate of interest is higher. As in, if somebody goes to a bank and avails of a loan at, say, whatever, 10%, as an example. If for some reason he is unable to get a bank loan at 10%, he would go to an own person, and the rate would be higher. Let's say 13% or 15%, whatever that rate is, the rate would be higher. So that concept today has been institutionalized or structured in a way. So there are certain entities which are RBI approved. There's RBI regulation on peer-to-peer, and these, I think, 20 odd entities are there. So these entities, they have applied to RBI for a license, and they are there in the market. So these peer-to-peer intermediaries, what do they do? They have a website. So both the sides, the person wanting a loan, who wants to take a loan, and the person who has some investable surplus, they both access the website. So this entity, these RBI approved entities, they are doing the job of bringing these two people together. So yes, it is a fixed income because the rate is defined and the rate is high. Now, one technical thing there, when you are taking a loan, apparently the rate of loan is very high, like 20, 30, 25%, something in that range. For the investor, as in who is giving a loan, the rate is not as high as 20, 30%. It's like whatever, 10, 15, 13, 12, something in that range. It's a technical thing because the interest you pay when you avail of a loan, it works on something called a reducing balance method. So when apparently you are availing of a loan at say 20%+, by virtue of that reducing balance method, in spite of whatever margin the agency may keep, the investor, the person giving a loan, ends up getting like whatever, let's say 13% as an example.
Mm-hmm.
So apart from these technicalities, what it simply means is, yes, you can go there. You can access this RBI approved entities website, and you can locate people who are desirous of taking a loan, and you can give loan, and the rate of return is high.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, what is the risk? The risk is these entities, they don't have any legal obligation in case of default. Mm-hmm. In case the person taking a loan defaults, there is no legal responsibility, which is true for mutual funds also.
Mm-hmm.
So if a mutual fund invests in ILFS and if ILFS defaults, the mutual fund is not legally obligated to make it good from their pocket. The risk is on the unit holder. That is same for mutual fund and this thing also. Only that the mutual fund will do the follow-up, as in whatever legal case, EAV, whatever is there, they will do. Similarly, the entity, that intermediary, they may help you in getting a lawyer, they will talk to you, you can do this, you can do that, but there is no legal responsibility. But net-net, I would say, yes, you can do it, because what you can do is you spread out. You have rupees so much to lend through this peer-to-peer mechanism. Instead of giving it to one person, you give it to so many persons. And even if, okay, defaults don't happen every day. And even if in a stray case of one default, normally it is made up by the higher rate of interest you earn from the other people who are not defaulting. And as per RBI regulation, there is a ceiling. The entire amount of loan which you can avail of through the peer-to-peer mechanism, there's a limit on that. How much an individual can lend through this mechanism, there's a limit on that also. So it is not possible to lend crores or borrow crores through this peer-to-peer mechanism. RBI has put limits on that. That risk mechanism is already put in place. Within those limits, you give loans to multiple people. I hope there is no default. In case if something happens, okay. I mean, generally, yes, you can do it.
But so, it's again that yes. If do you have the risk to kind of invest in this kind of instrument, right? And you need to kind of spread out your investment. So that in that way, even if any default also, it's okay kind of thing.
Yeah. So let me give an example. Let us say you have investment of a sizable amount, say 50 lakh or 1 crore, through the usual mutual fund route, a good quality mutual fund or a good quality bond and all those things. As against that, let us say you have 10 lakh. Now in a mutual fund today, in a good quality portfolio yield is how much? Say 5% or whatever that number is. As against that, if you're getting say 13% on a peer-to-peer mechanism, instead of against 50 lakh or 1 crore through the mutual fund or a bond route, you invest say 10 lakh through this mechanism. And as long as there is no default, you get 13% return.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are spreading it out, then your risk is diversified.
Correct.
So that you can try, because you know these new things are developing nowadays. So you can try it out to an extent.
I think it's a one way. There are a lot of buzz around it. I think it's coming to Kerala also. I think in Mumbai, Bangalore, it's a lot of buzz is there about this. Yeah.
You know, I will make a very generic point, not about this peer-to-peer thing. If you look at it, people like you and me, or people who would avail of loans from the peer-to-peer lending mechanism, more often than not, people are by intention honest. And if you look at the banking industry, the defaults, the big defaulters, who are the big defaulters, the big promoters?
Yeah.
If you look at the cases referred to this IBC, NCLT, all the big steel companies, SR Steel, Bhushan Steel, and all those big steel companies, big amount in default, and much bigger than all this Vijay Mallya case, or much bigger than all this Nirav Modi case. By intention, they're bad, and they're the big promoters, so that also is there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I think giving money to small people, it won't create much of problem to take the money back.
Hopefully.
No, I think there is a new technique happening. This is like most of the Muthoot and all that gold loans is giving exclusively for women. If you look at the new advertisement, they're saying that loan for this one, and they're saying that a woman only loan kind of thing. I think if any woman take the loan, or if in the family also in the name of woman is taken, that loan will be repaid, and they don't want to get into any trouble. It's a generic statement, but I think this is a new trend. It's happening. Yeah.
Okay. So soft aspects do matter. Like you said, this aspect it does matter.
Yeah. It's good. I think I have taken about 10 minutes extra, but I will thank you so much. I think could you just give a final comment on the entire session, so then from there we can stop the session.
So the final comment is, for investing in debt, mutual fund is always there. Of course, there it goes without saying, mutual fund has become a commodity, which is there for everybody, from a small individual retail investor 5,000 rupees to big corporates who invest like 100,000 crore rupees. It is there. As against that, there are certain pockets. Like in Kerala, you have that state government sponsor giving like whatever, 6.5-7%, which is a good return, state government sponsor. In bonds, I showed you those pockets, like 81 or 8 tax fees and all MLDs and all those. Or like you say, peer-to-peer. So apart from the commodity, which is debt mutual fund, these pockets like reasonably safe but high rate of return deposits, or these certain bonds giving a high rate of return, you can try out those things also for a certain part of your debt portfolio. So that is the final thing.
Thank you so much. Today's session, it was. I'm sure that the same recorded session will be saved in our YouTube and Facebook also, and this will be sending to our other existing database also. So I'm sure that this will add a lot of value for our community in terms of thinking about investing into direct bonds. I think direct bond is something it's picking up, and not in Kerala especially, we have a tendency to watch a lot of advertisement from all the gold finance companies, and there are good number of people are investing money also. So I think this session definitely add a lot of value for our community, and will take a lot of studied research before taking the investment decision. Okay, thank you so much. This is your second session for our community on behalf of my and their community, and on my behalf. Thank you so much. Thank you.
And Nandi.
Nandi. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. So thank you all. Ellavarkkum Nandi. This session attend cheyda ellavarkkum oru valued aayirunnu vicharikkunnu. Appo namukku adutha session il ini kaanam. Thank you so much.